rocks cry out to worship, whose glory taught the stars to shine. Perhaps creation longs to have the words to sing, but this joy is mine. With a thousand hallelujahs, we magnify your name. You alone deserve the glory, the honor, and the praise. Lord Jesus, this song is forever yours. A thousand hallelujahs and a thousand more. Who else would die for our redemption? Whose resurrection means a right? There isn't time.
Well, good morning once again, and welcome to our Thursday morning select gathering of friends who are here to take communion. We also pray together, we also worship. And you're very welcome to join with us in this act of remembrance of our Lord Jesus Christ. But of course, we'd love to see you in person. That would be even great. So give them a wave, everybody.
Hi.
Hi. Yeah. See, we're a friendly bunch, so you're very welcome to join us here on a Thursday morning at 10:30 or in church on Sunday at 10:30 as well. But Liz will be leading communion for us today, so I'll hand over to her.
So as we come to communion, I just want to use this opportunity because we do focus on Jesus, don't we? So let's use this as an opportunity to start as we mean to go on and talk to Jesus. Now, I haven't planned this and I have no idea where it will take us, but let's try it. Let's talk to Jesus about what this means. There's power in the blood. Jesus gave himself voluntarily, despite the pain. And that was physical and emotional and spiritual and mental. We know that it was total. His sacrifice was complete. Why? So that we could do this, so that we could do the talking to Jesus throughout our life. He wanted to give us a way, and he did. So to me, this speaks of thanking Jesus rather than asking him for things. So let's thank Jesus that he gave his body and his blood, and then we'll share the physical evidence of it just to make sure we've got the message. This was real as this piece of bread and this drink of juice. It stands for something that actually happened. It's not just a ritual. So Jesus, we just want to say thank you. Let's do that in our hearts, all of us, out loud, whatever. Let's together for a minute just say thank you, Jesus. Thank you for what you did for us. Thank you that it's ongoing, that it's an everyday experience, living and talking to you. And we specifically this morning want to say thank you that you gave yourself, knowing that we would need this to even live, because through it you conquered death. That's the essence of it. Because you conquered death, we can live, and we can do nothing but say thank you.
Behold the Lamb who bears our sins away, slain for us.
Thinking of that song, give thanks with a grateful heart. Give thanks to the Holy One. Give thanks that he has given Jesus Christ his Son. And now let the weak say I am strong. Let the poor say I am rich. because of what the Lord has done for us. Hold on to the cup and we'll drink together.
Give thanks with a grateful heart. Give thanks to the Holy One. Give thanks because He's given Jesus Christ, His Son. Give thanks with a grateful heart. Give thanks to the Holy One. Give thanks because He's given Jesus Christ, His Son. And
now... So with grateful hearts, we say thank you and drink it until Jesus comes again.
Hard day. Our new puppy chewed a hole in my favorite shirt. My brother ate the last of the cereal, and I stepped in a puddle and my socks got all wet. Oh, and I almost forgot. I also bit my tongue.
Hard days remind me of Paul and Silas in the book of Acts. Trust me, they had some really hard days.
Kinda like my day?
Even worse, Paul and Silas went all the way to Rome to teach people about Jesus. They did amazing things there through God's power.
That all sounds pretty great to me.
Well, some people didn't like it. They took Paul and Silas to the city rulers and accused them of causing trouble. Then, the rulers ordered soldiers to beat Paul and Silas with wooden rods.
That's awful!
It was. Then they put Paul and Silas in prison and told the jailer to make sure they didn't escape.
Were Paul and Silas really upset?
Actually, they prayed and sang songs of praise to God while the other prisoners listened. Then, around midnight, there was a huge earthquake.
Great, so things got even worse?
No, they got better. As the prison shook, the doors flew open and the prisoners' chains fell off. Then...
Wait, let me guess. Paul and Silas and all the other prisoners escaped?
That's what the jailer thought too. When he woke up and found the prison doors open, he thought all the prisoners must have gotten out. He was so afraid, he took out his sword to kill himself.
What? Why would he do that?
He thought the soldiers would kill him anyway for not doing his job. But just then, Paul called out to him from inside the jail. He said, "Wait, don't kill yourself. See? We're all still here."
Wait, you mean no one escaped?
That's right. Since Paul and Silas chose to praise God, even though they were wrongfully imprisoned, all the prisoners were amazed. They did the right thing. They didn't escape, even when they had the chance.
The jailer must have been really happy.
He was. He took Paul and Silas to his house, where they ate a meal together. And Paul and Silas got to tell everyone in the jailer's family about Jesus. Everyone believed and was baptized.
Wow, Paul and Silas made a big difference, even on a hard day.
Yep, even when things were hard, they showed everyone that God is always good, no matter what else is going on.
You know what? God is good.
All the time.
Okay. So while you're just pouring your coffee, or you're just thinking about things, or just chewing on your chocolate, I just want you to think about something else. I'd love you to think about, how do you define joy? How would you define joy? If I came and said to you, how would you define, what's your working hypothesis of joy? Yeah, Jesus, J-O-Y, J-O-Y, surely it must be. Jesus first, yourself last, others in between. That's an old chorus, Bryony, isn't it? Hey, you remember that one?
Yeah.
I used to sing that in Sunday school when I was small. I was never small. When I was young, that's better. That's it. No, thanks, Paul. I'm okay. I was never small. Yeah, when I was born, the midwife said to my mother, boy, that boy's going to be big. Look at the size of his hands. And I think I've just borne that out, haven't I? Hey. So, how would you define joy? Jesus first, yourself last, others in between. That's, yeah. Anything else? Anybody else? I asked my mother, who's 93, yesterday, how would you define joy? And she said, it's a moment when you feel at one with God. I thought that was a pretty good definition. I was quite happy with that. I thought that was really good. Anybody else want to add anything to it?
I feel like it's a choice.
Like, a choice. Yeah, good. Yeah, okay, it's a choice, yes, to be joyful, yeah. Kim? Yes, peace of God in the midst of difficulty. Of course, James chapter 1 says that. Consider it pure joy, my brothers and sisters, when you face trials of many kinds, doesn't he? Consider it joy when you face trials, isn't that? That's like almost an oxymoron. Do you know what an oxymoron is, yeah? Okay, that's almost like an oxymoron, isn't it? How can you be joyful in the midst of trials? Well, it's the peace of God that comes and resides with you. Is it something that is almost nebulous? You know, so it's out there, and it's something that we strive for, and it's something that we tried to grasp hold of, but is actually unattainable. Is that what joy is? No, I don't think so either. Joy, then, is a very, very important fruit of the Spirit that grows within us as we become more Christ-like. So, hey, if we're feeling a bit static today, you know, I'm not really growing in faith, I'm not really moving on with God, then somehow your joy might be less than it should be. Maybe your love is less than it should be, like we talked about last week. You know, some of the fruit of the Spirit, it's a dynamic thing. It's part of who we are. It never stops growing. It never stops developing. It never stops moving. The fruit of the Spirit continually grows in us if we draw near to Christ. Now, of course, then, the opposite must be true. If we pull away from Christ, if we say, well, you know, I used to be really on fire, but I'm not on fire anymore. I've heard that so often. You know, well, you know, somebody said something and then I heard the gossip and then I was really hurt and now I'm going to stay hurt forever. You know, all of that kind of stuff. It just robs us of joy. So let's put all that to bed, shall we? Because I want to say to you three things this morning, and they're going to be really quick. Joy has a history. Joy has a history. It's associated with that precious moment when we receive the salvation that God in Christ shared with us. I just wanted to take you back to that moment. Our sins at that point were blotted out. I love to think of, you know, when I started at Barclays Bank back in 1973, that's a long time ago, isn't it? We had to write our entries in a ledger. Okay, it's a big, huge book that sat on your desk. There was none of this computerized stuff. Okay, you had to physically, every check that came in and every money you paid out, you had to write it in your ledger book. Okay, I love to think, You know, and you have to balance your book at the end of the day. Oh boy, that was always a scary moment. I think that God takes hold of our life leisure book, right? Where all of those entries are, all of the sins that we've done, all of the wrongdoings, all the thoughts that we've had, all of the stuff we know we shouldn't have done, and stuff we have done that we know we shouldn't have done, and all that kind of stuff. And he takes hold of it and he rips all the pages out and he says, it's over, it's ended, it's finished. No longer on the debit side is there anything that you have to pay for, because Jesus is all of our credit. Jesus is all of our credit. He is for us. And he has done incredible things. So just let me take you back, because you're going to do this in a minute. Is that okay? We were made righteous by God and for God, and we were sealed with the Holy Spirit. Can you remember that moment in your life? Okay, so can you just remember the joy of that moment when you put your faith and your trust in Jesus? That joy of that moment? It is amazing, isn't it? Absolutely amazing. So joy has a history. There's a history of something joyful happened to us at a moment in our lives when we put our faith and our trust in Jesus. What a moment that was. I can remember when I was 7 years of age, being in a children's meeting and having that conviction of the Holy Spirit come upon me and giving my life to Jesus at that moment. It was the most amazing moment, I think, in my whole life. Apart from finding Sue, of course.
Well said.
So Psalm 16 and verse 11 says, you make known to me the path of life. You will fill me with joy in your presence. That's where we want to be, guys. Right in the middle of his presence, filled with joy. But not only does joy have a history, joy has a present. A here and a now as we advance in faith. As Nehemiah says, the joy of the Lord is our strength. Cole, are you feeling a bit weak today? The joy of the Lord is a promise to be your strength. It is, absolutely. As we share in the sufferings of our human frailty, as I said to you earlier, James chapter 1 says, consider it pure joy, my brothers and sisters, whenever you face trials of many kinds, because you know that the testing of your faith produces perseverance. We don't like that bit, do we? We don't like the bit where actually, you know, the testing of our faith, is it real? Is it genuine? Is it grounded? Is it in the right place, in the right person? You know, are we following somebody on the internet rather than following Jesus? That's very dangerous, guys. I just want to tell you. Okay? Follow Jesus. And your faith will never, ever be put to shame. It will never fail. Joy is a dynamic fruit of the Spirit. As I said before, it's not static. It can be affected by our sin. But true repentance leads to a renewed heart, which is filled with joy as we rejoice in the awesome grace of our Savior. Romans 15 and verse 13 says, may the God of hope fill you with all joy. Not just a tiny bit. It doesn't say joy. It says all joy. And peace as you trust in him so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. So joy has a history, joy has a present, but joy also has a future. We will know a complete future and a fullness of joy when we're amongst those who celebrate the wedding feast of the Lamb. Revelation 19 verse 7 says, let us rejoice and be glad and give him glory, for the wedding of the Lamb has come and his bride has made herself ready. We will rejoice, joy in the middle of rejoicing. And in Philippians 4 verse 7, verse 4, it says, rejoice in the Lord always. I will say again, rejoice. Let your gentleness, you know, joy brings us to a point where we're more Christ-like. The Lord is near. So this morning, if you're a believer and you believe in Jesus today, this verse is for you. This is 1 Peter 1 verse 8. Though you have not seen him, you love him. And even though you do not see him now, you believe in him and are filled with an inexpressible and glorious joy. Well, three of you believe it anyway. I'll do it again, shall I? And let's all do it together. Though you have not seen him, you love him. And even though you do not see him now, you believe in him and are filled with an inexpressible and glorious
joy.
What are you receiving?
Joy.
For you are receiving the end result of your faith, the salvation of your souls. Do we need more joy in our lives? Yes, I do. Well, today, here's an offer. Come to Jesus. Amen. Know him as your personal friend and savior. Know him in a deeper way than you've ever known him before. Because that's his promise. He will come to you when you ask him and be filled with an inexpressible and glorious joy. Shall we pray together? Perhaps you want to just ask the Lord for that inexpressible and glorious joy to fill your life this morning. Come, Holy Spirit. Come, Holy Spirit. We welcome you, Holy Spirit. Minister to us the fruit of joy in our lives. Fill us with joy again, Lord. May our strength be your joy today. Whatever circumstance we're in right now, your joy makes so much difference to us. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. And we pray that, Lord, as you minister to us, so we would be sent from this place to share the joy that you have given to us. Because whenever you give us something very special like that, like love, like joy, etc., etc., you want us to give it away to others. May we be people of joy through this week. We pray it in Jesus' name.
I'm trading my sorrows, I'm trading my shame, and I'm laying them down for the joy of the Lord. And I'm trading my sickness, and I'm trading my pain, and I'm laying them down for the joy of the Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord, amen. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord, amen.
Amen. I am pressed but not crushed, persecuted not abandoned, struck down but not destroyed. I am blessed beyond the curse, for his promise will endure, and his joy is gonna be my strength. Though sorrow may last for the night, his joy comes with the morning. Oh, and I'm trading my sorrows, I'm trading my shame, and I'm laying them down for the joy of the Lord.
Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord.